Welcome back to Celebrity Radio. It's Alex Belfield talking to some of the country's biggest stars, some of my favourite people, and legends too. Susie Blake, how are you?
I'm not a legend. I thank you very much. That's very sweet of you.
You are. Let's start at the beginning. I mean, from Victoria Wood to Coronation Street to Some Mothers Do Have Them, you've done it all.
Yes. I am very lucky that I've done a lot of variety, you know, a big variety of stuff, working with comics and also doing straight stuff as well, and lots of theatre.
Where I first saw you was in the West End live, and it was in Wicked as Madame Marrable, and I thought you were so remarkable and so incredible and captivating, and that voice was just so penetrating in that huge great big theatre, and that's when you know you've got a bit of class. I just said to Joe, it's the sign of a true actress when you can reach the back in some of these huge theatres.
We did have microphones, I have to tell you, but yes, I do. My mum had a lovely voice, and I suppose we all inherit whatever we're given, don't we?
Yeah. In this show, you become a bit of a lush, and I understand by the end of it, you're completely legless. It must be fun doing this.
Well, it is. The trouble is there are so many people my age who have become alcoholics. You know, it's very, very fashionable for the baby boomers. Right. So I hope it's funny. It's always a bit risky playing a drunk because some people really don't like it. So I'm trying my best to make her humorous and blame the prune wine.
Well, and again, we must remember this is comedy and it is set in the 70s, so that's your get-out-of-jail clause, isn't it?
Yes, definitely.
What's it like being you at this point? I mean, so few people have longevity. To me, that's the key to success. If you're still here 20, 30, 40 years later, you've made it. And you're in that position. You've had such a great career. And we'll never mention all the names you've worked with. It's really, A, lucky that you've been able to meet them. B, testament to your talent.
Well, if I had to work it out, I suppose I would say I wasn't picked up early. I wasn't a beauty. I mean, I've been fairly pretty in my time, but I was never a great beauty. I didn't get into the film industry because I think that's quite specific and you make a few films and probably, you know, survive on that. But I've never stopped working. And so it's just, I just say yes to everybody, really.
Answer the phone, I'll do it.
Yep, absolutely.
Were there highlights? I mean, for me, the Victoria Wood thing has become iconic. And again, losing Vic is unbelievable even now. I guess for you to just be around those type of people, I mean, if you never worked again, it would be enough.
Yes, and they had the brains where I don't have an education because I went to ballet school and then stage school and then drama school and then out into the wide world. So to work with people who, and actually bright people never make you feel stupid. Our director, who also wrote this piece, Some Mothers Do Have Them, Guy Unsworth, and he never makes me feel as if I don't know what I'm talking about, even though I probably don't.
Indeed you do, but I mean, if we look in the case of Victoria Wood, she certainly wasn't some mass intellectual that played on that. Her comedy was aimed at roots level. That's what made it so glorious. She touched everybody, didn't she? Mm,
she did, but I think she was quite, in her way, her brain was particularly agile. To be a good musician, I think you do need to have a very good brain.
In the classic scene, you were doing that piece to camera about the North, and I'm from the North, by the way. How do you get through something like that without corpsing? Is it just doing it again and again, getting out your system?
Rehearsal. And of course, we don't get much of that now. There's no rehearsal on telly, really. When I did Coronation Street, there was no rehearsal. You might get to do it twice in front of the camera. But rehearsal is really undervalued now, and that's where you make discoveries, and that's where you make it your own, as opposed to just being a mouthpiece for the writer.
Right, and I guess that's what's glorious about something like this. You've crafted it over many weeks prior to arriving in a theatre, and then every night it grows and gets better and better.
Yes, and I've just been talking to Guy about it. I've been finding reasons why I have to move into certain places. In technically, to be somewhere, you have as an actor to find a reason for being there. And after you've seen the show, I'll tell you why I have justified doing some of the things I do.
I was meant to see it last week. I tried to get to Buxton, but unfortunately, it was about 9 inches of snow.
Oh gosh, it was beautiful though. It was a fantastic week because a lot of bonding went on. We made two snowmen, and we were literally, I had wellies on the whole week. It was so beautiful, and I don't know about the other people, but I had fantastic digs up there, and it's the most lovely town. So we had a lovely holiday.
And a huge theatre with not many people on it when it was too snowy.
No, but they gave us a standing ovation. It was really lovely. We did a matinee to 13 people. Everybody else came on the last Saturday, so it was completely full, floor to ceiling. It was heaven.
I would have loved to have been there, only because a night like that will never be repeated, and you'll never forget it, will you?
No, never.
It's glorious. Let's talk about the show itself and how complicated it is with the words, because the writing of this is key. It won't work if it's not funny. Working with someone like Joe, he can be a bit naughty from time to time, and he does like to switch things up. Is it exciting to be part of a fast-paced, fast really, isn't it?
Yes. He has a massive, massive role. And I think that he would be taking a big risk if he went off-piste, as it were. By the way, this play is going to be published by French's. Isn't that fantastic? Isn't that wonderful? Yes, he has a lot of words to say, and I think he would find it difficult to get back on the track again with a fast-moving farce, which this is. Really, it's a love story, okay, I know he'll say that, but it's also a farce, and you can't really take time out to have your own bit of fun on the side, because you'd never get back on the train, everybody else will have moved on.
And then we look at something like this compared to Coronation Street. I mean, I love the guys. I've spoke to the William Roaches 100 times. It's hard work, that, as you say, because there's no rehearsal, but it's also somewhat laborious, the waiting around. There isn't that with theatre. I guess it's the balance. You've been lucky to do both. Would you rather do a show every night that is going to end up different, or being in a nice, cosy studio where you can do, you might have to wait 6 hours, but you can do your business and then go home?
There wasn't much waiting on Coronation Street. And, of course, the story's changing all the time. So that is what is different. So I like playing lots of different parts and lots of different characters, which is why I've, you know, freed myself up to be available to do lots of different things. But one forgets that on a soap, the story changes, whereas in the theatre, the story is the same every night, but you're telling that story from beginning to end. You have control of it. There's no cameras, there's no director, they've all gone, and it's up to you and the audience to have a fantastic time together.
And I remember Ken Dodd saying to me once, it's about that invisible thread, that rapport that you've got to build so quick. Yes, and yes. That's the joy, isn't it?
Yes, letting people in. Fantastic.
Yeah. If you were to sort of put a top three of the people that even you were in awe of, I mean, when people work with you now, I spoke to this cast, they're in awe of you. Have there been people where you've gone, I can't believe I'm stood next to you?
In the early days, yes. Really, when I was very young, in 76, so I would have been 26, my first West End job, was with Joan Plowright, and I was petrified. And every time she spoke, she rattled her bangles on her wrist. Or every time I spoke, rather, when we had one rehearsal together, because I took over from Helen Mirren, so I was coming in late, so she didn't rehearse with me until the actual day before I went on. So that, I was very in awe of her. And Laurence Olivier actually came and stood in the wings, and I couldn't believe that. I mean, that was out of this world. Wow. Whereas when I talked about Laurence Olivier when I was on Coronation Street, the kids hadn't heard of him. Oh my God, I can't even believe. So yes, I mean, more recently, it was brilliant working with Vic, but then we kind of grew up together. So that was a different set of circumstances, really.
Is she totally irreplaceable? Will anybody ever be as funny as Victoria?
No, not in the way that she was. No, there are some copycats, but they can't do it.
I know. It's incredible, isn't it? And we look back, I mean, that beautiful Royal Albert Hall show she did was her finest.
Hit again.
Doing the just wonderful parody. And there was an edge of sort of zinger about her as well. She wasn't a nice comic in a sense that it was all cutesy-cutesy knock-knock jokes. She made a point, and she made it so well.
Yes, she did, because she used herself as the fall guy. So she didn't hurt other people, but she could point things out very clearly, especially in the little sketches. Heart-rending, some of them.
Yeah, indeed. And she could always match that tragedy with the comedy, which is that perfect balance. I wonder what it's like being a female actress now at your level with your credibility. Just this afternoon, I did an interview about Me Too with Alicia Dixon, who's the sort of new crop of celebrity and star. I wonder whether you've ever encountered any sexism, or have you just defined yourself by being good?
This is going to sound awful. When I was a child of the 60s, well, 70s, I suppose. And so it was quite hard at the time to identify the enemy, if you like, you know, being taken advantage of. But I think if you're with your own age group and you're with your mates, that seems to me the safest place to be in a gang. I never came across any trouble at auditions or that in the workplace from older people of any, you know, description making me feel awkward. I think there was one person once who came on to me, but you know, I was confident enough, and that's another key thing, brought up by a loving mother who gave me lots of confidence to just sort of laugh and go away. And I was followed once by a musician out of a theatre, and I went back in and pretended I'd forgotten something and sort of got an actor to help me out of that situation. So, because I've been thinking about it, I'm sure every actor has, but I've been very fortunate, and I don't think I ever looked vulnerable, even though I looked like the girl next door. I was quite tough and knew what I wanted, I think.
Do you know how loved you are and respected you are? Do you even give that any time and thought? Because
is
I mean,
that coming from you? Because are you available?
Yes and
I
yes.
I don't know that. No, of course I don't know that.
No, but it's so wonderful to meet someone who's so credible and has done so much. I mean, you've been with us throughout our entire life, certainly my generation and even my mum's generation. You know, you've been there, and that's such a gift for us to have.
I think I'm blushing. Oh my goodness. No, I don't think of. I mean, I think of myself as a grand. With an allotment. That's how I think of myself. And as soon as I get back from being on tour, you know, I'm down to the allotment. I was wrapping silver foil around the trunk of my damson tree this weekend, and I have to put Vaseline on it in May to stop the moths climbing up from the ground and eating my
Vaseline-ing your damson tree. This sounds like a Victoria Wood sketch. Does this thing really exist?
And I travel by public transport. Nobody gives me a second look. So, no, I don't. I mean, it's lovely of you to say that, but you're in this environment. And so in this environment and among my peers, I suppose, we all know each other. But I don't feel that...
I'm talking about in my living room. I'm talking about the fact you've been coming out of my TV for as long as I can remember.
Yes, I suppose that is true. Yes.
And then to be in this show very finally, it must be a great thrill. I mean, they could pick anyone. I always do this line. It doesn't have to be you, but they chose you. Do you wonder why, or do you just turn up and do the gig?
I just turn up and do the gig. That's the easy answer, isn't it?
I don't blame you, so would I.
I think the third week of rehearsal, or the second, if you've got 3 weeks, which we had, you think, why? Why did they cast me? I'm never going to be able to, you know, this is impossible. And you look at everybody else, they're all so good. And that's a great thing, that moment where you realise that everybody's so good and you think, well, I hope I'm like them. I hope that I can, you know, produce what they're producing. And then the last week you all pull together, and then the first night, you know, you're all holding hands. And we've had a lovely time so far, so long may it last.
And I've been talking to Joe for weeks through the rehearsal and through opening night and all that, and it's always gone well. This show just feels right, doesn't it?
Yes, it's a lovely feeling. I come on early for my entrances and stand in the wings like Mrs. Overall listening, because it's just, oh, are they going to get this bit? Yes. And then they get something different, and that's the joy. The show's the same, it's the audience that's different.
Congratulations on everything. Thank you so much for your time, and come and see Some Mothers Do Have Them on tour across the UK. Susie, it's such a pleasure to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you.